Robynne Quiggin. I'm Professor and Associate Dean of Indigenous at UTS Business School in the Law Faculty. Welcome to Mara. We begin, as we always do, acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which we meet. We acknowledge that we meet on the land of the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation. And we always stop when we do and pause when we do this acknowledgement and reflect on whose land we are working, living, to cast our mind, our imagination, down below the carpentry floor, below all the concrete, below all the steel, to the land underneath us, to the land potentially underground waterways, to the rock, to the sandstone, the land of food, the voice and the language of the Gadigal for 60,000 years, that lived with the Gadigal, that knew the Gadigal people as they practiced culture, ceremony, collected food, raised their children, buried their dead, lived life for 60,000 years, generation after generation, on this country, this land. And if you cast your mind down to it and reflect on the fact, is this a land of the Gadigal? The traditional owners of this place, the guests, on their country, acknowledge their ancestors, their descendants, their care for country today, their ongoing care for country, and they pay respects on our behalf tonight as we meet here today. We also pay respects to our Indigenous brothers and sisters here today and all the non-Indigenous guests who have come to participate in tonight and this evening. So, we're really on the Jumbunna Institute and the Centre for Social Inclusion. I'm really happy to be here tonight to present this panel of eminent speakers to talk about treaty. So, just reflecting on how did we get here, how come we're here having this conversation now? We know there are things we know and things we don't know. We know that at the time that the British came here, there must have been discussions, there must have been negotiations of some kind, there must have been engagement in that. Where was the fresh water? How do you move through this country? There must have been engagement and negotiations at the time. We know there was violence, but we know there was destruction, we know there was disease, but there must also have been discussions and negotiations at the very beginning. We know what we now call Melbourne. There were negotiations and, in fact, for a brief period of time, an agreement between a private agriculturalist and the Wiradjuri people of that country. It was broken, that agreement was broken very quickly by the government, and President Robynne Quiggin knew about that agreement. We also know that the European international law to distance at the time said there should be a treaty. When you go to someone else's country peacefully, allegedly peacefully, create a treaty. So we know that there were those expectations, that that was the standard at the time. We know that in other countries, in New Zealand, in Canada, in the United States, there were treaties, but not here. And so we are here now, still having this conversation. So I want to begin by also introducing the panel. We have in the middle the Honourable Linda Burney. Linda is a member of the Wiradjuri Nation, member of the House of Representatives, former elected at Barton, Shadow Minister for Families and Social Services, and Shadow Minister for Indigenous Australians. And Linda was elected federal member in 2016, following a 14-year career in New South Wales Parliament as a member for Canterbury, where she held senior portfolios. Linda was the first Aboriginal person to be elected to the New South Wales Parliament, and the first Aboriginal woman to serve in the Australian House of Representatives. Please welcome Linda. On Linda's left, Jason Mifsud, who is a member of the Eastern Mar people of the Gunditjmara Nation in southwest Victoria. Jason is chair of the Eastern Mar Aboriginal Corporation and chair of the Victorian Federation of Traditional Owners. Tracy is currently leading the negotiations with the Victorian government on a traditional land settlement. Tracy was previously the executive director for Aboriginal Victoria at the Department of Permanent Cabinet, where he led the whole of government Aboriginal affairs reform agenda between the Victorian government and the Victorian Aboriginal community. This included establishing the architecture and governance arrangements to embed Aboriginal self-determination in cultural, social and economic policy, as well as the roadmap to a treaty agreement. Please welcome Tracy. And on my left, Professor Tom Calma. Tom is an elder for the Kungarakan tribal group and a member of the Iwaidja tribal group. He was senior ministerial advisor for a period of time at Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Social Justice Commissioner at the Australian Human Rights Commission from 2004 to 2010, and also Race Discrimination Commissioner from 2004 until 2009 at the Commission. His social justice report during that time was instrumental in establishing the now well-known Closing Gap campaign, which sets key benchmarks for Indigenous health and well-being. He is now National Coordinator tackling Indigenous smoking, a professor at the University of Sydney Medical School, and in 2014, Professor Calma became the first Indigenous man Chancellor at an Australian university at the University of Canberra. Please welcome Calma. So just before we get into questions, a couple of housekeeping issues. Please keep your phones on silent, but please keep them on also, and we encourage you to tweet using the hashtag TGWin and #NAIDOC2019. The filming tonight's session, and that will be available soon, so no need to record it yourselves. Bathrooms are way over there on the other side of the floor. And if there's an emergency, please follow the remaining signs. So, for the first question. The first question I want to ask our panel is, if you can have your wish list for treaty, who's the life thinking? In a relatively short answer, could you tell us what your wish list would be, what you would hope for? Linda, we might start with you.
My wish list is not treaty. The enormous challenge in my lifetime, my wish list would be a series of treaties across the country between government and individual nation states. Because that's the way in which our society is organized. Now, that's probably really blue sky thinking. Well, maybe it's not when you think about the Noongar Agreement in Western Australia. That is essentially a treaty. The Larrakia Agreement in Northern Territory is another such exercise. So we need to think about treaties in many different ways. Lots of people say, oh, we want a treaty. Well, that's okay, but if you want a treaty with the federal government, who is the treaty made with? And we know that we can't speak on behalf of our groups. So that is the enormous challenge. So I guess it would be a number of treaties that would be with local government authorities and state government and local and regional level. I also believe that we need a federal treaty. And when you think about that, what would a treaty at the federal level be about? What is the federal government basically responsible for? It's military policy. So it's really complex. But when you think about military policy, imagine, if you think about the Barton people, you think about all the money that goes into Barton country from government, this is millions of dollars. Wouldn't it be pretty good for Barton people was to start in that much respect? So there are the sorts of things that we need to think about when we think about treaty. It's an easy way to say, that the application is what we want to do. So my blue sky thinking to wrap it up would be wonderful. As you say, we should stay still, recognize the truth of the sovereignty that is sacred, and that's the difference. Thank you, Linda.
It is a complex, it's complex, yeah. It's been called agreement, I think it's complex. It's in North and South, it's been worse. And having said that, we've been a part of the current process to become foreign as well. I've had a lot of time to think about this question and there are no really pragmatic and practical and close-fit things on foreign needs and materials in North Korea that actually look like. My question, and one of the things that I've done is around re-establishing that social culture around those First Nations people. The big challenge in Victoria, like I'm doing this, is how we convene and what are the rules that we convene around to organise ourselves to get treaty ready, to get negotiation ready. And it's a really challenging thing in our communities. For all the reasons. Because that's been deliberately taken away from us because of settlement and all those kind of things. Those are contested parts and it's still essentially the minds of the communities. So for me, it's more practical around the direct benefit to Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander identity and more of them convening thousands and thousands and thousands of people who can convene their own campfires. The ability to convene is something that I've seen bring the Victorian community together. And it doesn't mean agreement. Because the magic of convening is we are here tonight and allows the dialogue to be ongoing and for us to re-establish that social and cultural order and ensure that we're organised to negotiate with governments, local, state, or federal. And that's the one of the risks that I see for us as a community. Conversation with community where that's just going to have because we see the greater challenge being authenticity by government. Because we've had that promise that's given to us now and taken away from us now. And I've got unbreakable belief in our community to continue to convene and to organise ourselves and make good progress. And I've seen many problems, I've seen many whole ways of surrounding the last 2 decades, and I'm sure we'll see the value in the future. Leading up to the treaty of the treaty of of course, you guys are really the other big ingredient in the district, but you're the ones that make the difference. 3% of Aboriginal people and the population are living in the way that they're not seeing the percentage of the population to come on board. And I think we need to really think about forming what we call treaties. The treaties between two sovereign parties. For us as Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander people, we are sovereign parties now. We can talk about it, but many people have been dispossessed and put, and they don't have anywhere to relate to. So they're going to be disenfranchised further if the free negotiations are between the government and the tribal group, or how's it going to go. And so whether it's formal treaties or whether it's agreements in some part, we have discussed it with our partners about. Well, we're looking at a different sort of process. So for me, it's that a treaty will emerge with certain people, but there's a lot to go into it before we even get there, that mind to that position of negotiation. And I think that's going to be a challenge for us to wind and referenda around the country, the rights for representation, rights for recognition, reparations for the need to have a leader, getting on the moon, maybe your own body, or the body's human, and needs to happen in the process. So the community has been very clear about that. The process to accomplish that is the boat the community still exists. And we've used the term for 5 years now. We have a working partner in the conversation very early days is the community is always worried about the government, incredibly, and the government is always worried about the community to organise those funds. I do it pretty hard to say that wrong. Whilst the doors open, let's get to work. Let's continue to make it work. It's not only what this is, but it's to say the government to keep a treaty making process. We need to come to terms with the position of sharing power and resources, and that needs to start today and stop sticking the nose in the ground in that community process. So that was a sort of a pulling of ties, just intrinsic relationships and power that come to you, that was our community. So, in many respects, I think that's a really strong template, and it's a strong foundation that the First Nations groups around the country can look at and modify. And in many respects, it's truly the principles of the Uluru statement in terms of the spiritual principles of power.
I think it's a fine process, don't you? Thank you.
Good fun, that was good fun.
Fantastic. I mean, as a regular woman and member of parliament, you have to respond to lots of different people and lots of stakeholder groups. Just wondering if you have any reflections on forward with all of those groups and your relationship to all of those groups and all of the work in this process to have all the stakeholders to respond to. Well, how about this, perhaps? I think the most important thing in a representative role is that you understand the seriousness. People put their faith in you. They cast their vote in the new great democracy. And that's a very precious thing. And you remind yourself every single day that it is precious and that you have responsibilities to the people who have put you in that position. And I think that one of the things I've learned in my life is that requires good negotiation. And most negotiations mean that both sides have to do something. And that's very much the thing with the treaty as well. And the other thing is that you show respect and you show kindness and you show generosity. Because quite often, people will come to their local member when they need everywhere else and they doesn't. And often you can't do anything practical except say, well, let's sit down and have a cup of tea and have another bite. For a lot of people, it's the first time someone's actually listened to the problem. And that means an awful lot. So that also is my lesson. It is it's hard work, but of course, on the other side, always saying that you treat people the way that you want to. That they're just because people have a different political background doesn't mean that they're a bad person. Sometimes it does. you just conduct yourself well. You conduct yourself with the values, and that seems to be useful. And just very quickly, the two things I just wanted to share with you was that I was up in the Northern Territory a few weeks ago and I was talking to Victor Barton, sharing his day. And the point that he made was a really important one. He was talking about his experience of treaty making internationally. He said the first thing is people have to be treaty ready.
So that can take 20 years. So we're not talking about this overnight thing, we're talking about if we as a community of communities are being treated well. And that was a concept that I hadn't thought about at all. And I guess the other thing that really is very salient, and I'm going to come back to the points that you were making, Jason, is that think about the last South Australian election, when it went from a Labor Party to a Conservative Party. The first treaty was about to be signed, and because it was so enmeshed in the government process, the Liberals decided that they would not continue with that treaty making process subsequent. So whatever we end up doing or deciding or where we go, it cannot be at the behest that a government can just stop it or change it because they want to. Which is why there is going to be one big conversation about voice to the parliament, because in many people's minds, we're still very much burnt by the ACCC experience, where a government decided that was it.
Most of the constitution, the state constitution, to rule that the recognition of language and class of people, so you've got both the state constitutions as well as the federal. And we often think federal is a little bit more responsibility, but the states also do. And I think that's the way we can really leverage. Even though the government has going back to the state constitutions, which we are in negotiations, we have the most effect in the quickest time, and federal levels are difficult and visible. And, my experience has not been as treaty, but we're saying, land rights legislation, and that process really opens the process. takes a long time, and even within the tribal groups, some people don't recognise that the common first families are like that. And so we don't know what people do with this franchise when you get down to the tribal again. The burden of the design of the trust and the people to stay in the same contract and connection with the council and culture. That's just a kind of organisation which is always difficult. In constitution, so it's probably something that is in place, and so we don't have it. So, other things, there's a number of ways that we go forward, written this in the federal constitution. That is one of the things that some of those clauses that the expert panel and constitution reform are inside, which then the whole process. A lot of submissions and a lot of recommendations came out of that speech to them. We now got the process that already started with us, but a number of other demands on the inside. It's how do we address those and not try to go through hard and move on to another review of the thing, the real consultations. And this is the three major institutional works that we've got to work from. But layer it. Some responsibilities at the federal level, the national level affects people who have got common legislation, and that rights acts, and the other is really going back into what the states can do. And just by way of example, what is it? In India, for example, kids are missing. Would you two different tribal groups in there? People being brought in, and what are the rights of people coming in versus the first families that are in that land, and I'm going to get the money, communities across the nation. So how do we address those issues of those people who aren't the first families and the first families? So there are some really big challenges.
So I think that there are various issues around like traditional monuments and people who come into country and some issues that we've been doing in the country. And so I just want to ask you about again, or ask all of you about getting treaty ready in community, but also in government, in the role of the Makarai, the potential role of the Makarai Commission that was proposed in the East government. So it's given the experience in Victoria. Emotions that we will have to contend with in this country, whether you're a black farm or a white farm, will have to deal with hurt, fear, and frustration.
will have to universally contend with one of those two emotions. So whether you care when you end up, whether you want to decide to care, whether you want to decide in a timely, that'll be the three emotions we're going to contend with. The inclusivity in the Victorian context was one of the first things that we said. That is a culture that we're going to agree on. But we have about 40,000 they will have a clear democratic moment to try to do the selection process for working with them. Those are complex conversations. The process that I just gave to that, as I said, no, that's a boring way of commitment to the register. The outcome, it's important in the way. So if you're a Victorian Aboriginal priest or woman, you can be involved in the Victorian election and you can stand as a nominee for the candidacy in the election. If you're a non-Victorian CEO that can be in Victoria, and I know you know the boundary, the whole boundary thing, you know, the sense of that conversation, because Burney's only in the constituency and all those sorts of things. But if you're a non-Victorian CEO and you live in Victoria for 3 years, you can enroll and still have your vote, it's a current standard. So we've tried to moderate the nobody left behind principle in the process of elections and that candidacy, who I believe will go into an assembly. And then there's the other nuances around sovereignty and how we support them. There's some questions in that process that either I often find that position is comfortable. Some of those questions are, in this first election process, when I ask the people that I've been before, where they know me. Now, I've had to think deeply about that question. But then when you go back to the principle of inclusivity, and we have people that support us through the emotional balance of their journey and their process, it stops them. So in our next election, or the election after that, because we're through the election cycles, we'll have time to think our way through confirmation that we know our questions. We can't afford to wait for it to be perfect before we have to work on it. These are the sequence. So if you've got a problem, where does it have to fit in sequence? Is this journey of agreement making? And they're just internal Aboriginal questions. But we're not even talking about what we're dealing with on government terms. So these are just some practical examples around who speaks the country. If you're not in the country, do you still have to run the primary process? All the benefits in our view, in Victoria, so we're all Aboriginal parents are the people who live in the state of Victoria. If you're a PR living in this country, you can still run the way in the process. There's always sort of pros and cons, there's always things you've got to contend with, but they're achievable. And we're going to continue to do that in the
future. I think one of the challenges for us is to be really clear about what we're talking about. If you unpack the new statement, which was a very simple document, it talked about three things. It talked about a voice to the Parliament, which was the only part of the Uyghur statement that required referendum challenge. The other two bits were Makarrata Commission, and that means treaty and agreement making. And the third bit was the national process of truth telling. So, one of the things I think is going to be a real challenge for us over the next few months is to not allow people to mix all those things together. Because that's what I heard from the usual suspects today, James Cain and Putney. And you know, So it's really, really important because I heard people going down the track today of conflating treaty with a voice and saw the red-headed one on television the other night. Why that? Well, you just really have to keep the freehand title. Another person today talking about a pipeline system in Australia. These are things that we need to be very clear about. And we're talking about three different things. A voice to the Parliament is not the same discussion as treaty, but they may be connected in another way. Because that voice might be the only national body that there is to negotiate a national treaty. And let's get our ducks lined up in the proper order.
How do you differentiate between the legal implications of that. as the management of the treaty, which is the negotiation between the two sides, and to be agreed between the two sides. And I'm still thinking about legal binding effect. I think the big thing about the NAIDOC agreement was that they were realizing that rather than having individual agreed, it took a long time to get the agreement among the district number of people and places, and probably to tell you that done as well. And that had a very significant impact, and I think this is the challenge of some of us that we have to do. But it all points to a very long time over 10 years, and it was an exchange of revenue because people couldn't find money. There's still a long way to go, and there's still a lot of disagreement within. We just mentioned it very briefly earlier about redress and compensation, and that's also becoming a real issue for some people, because some might be seeking cash compensation, and there might be clear that we still have considerations in that process. But the given part of the agreement was that to sign an offer. That they would forego any future plans of the running. And it's a really big concession, and they can't take a step aside. That's in the best interest of the state, as well as for Calma, because the biggest problem that we have with any land settlement argument in Calma is that most of the people that go through the process are all well and truly dead by the time that they have come off the Calma land. So, in all of us, we don't want to. There is generation after generation of average people who never benefit from what we could get. I think some really good, solid agreements in a short period of time to get the real governments and the people.
So, I think
that
I wonder if you want to reflect a little bit on how we actually have these conversations about colonisation, about sovereignty, about things that people feel very strongly about to some extent and are intractable, and it's how we have these conversations about such emotional and romantic realities for us and conflicts for us, and that we are the generation that are looking at having to really grapple with these things. And government thinks about the fact that they are being asked to deal with a settlement or a process at this point in time. But we also have that question, I think, that always comes up in community colonisation, sovereignty, and we can be the people and are we able to walk up to that? Those big questions.
Well, it's really is a different question on the people and those questions. And we want to, and we can see, because there are many problems in other countries, we've got the treaties and the countries. We're only 3% of the population, and so we're the ones who need to work, and we only 7% of those who have to give to be able to make the first round of what we have and how we work. And so that's potentially itself and why we need to have this discussion, because as long as there's that tension existing, people feel that they might be losing something rather than giving something to the first people. I'm accepting that all of that, that's just the Victorian, probably reshuffle the maze. Just a few years ago, arguing that never happened to the TV. You know, the stolen generation didn't happen, etc. But you guys are the ones that are the first to believe that we will accept that some of these things happen, to recognise that the conflicts that we've been experiencing as young people have had some possible impacts on us, the intergenerational trauma, the lack of opportunity, etc. And they will, and that's why young people take their own lives, they abuse their substances, and we have achieved in a whole range of areas, and because we just haven't had the opportunity, or the impact that we have on the children's own time that we've experienced. So, throughout your field,
been doing it for a very, very long time. And that's why I think the third component of the award statement and why it's so important, because that talks about the national process of closure. Now, we have the 10-year decade of reconciliation, some really significant work being done on the continuation of reconciliation study, including a conversation going within our own communities, I think that one thing that I've noticed is that there's something in language a lot. You know, I don't speak my language, but you make an effort, particularly at significant things, to learn some words, to learn some sentences, so that you can retain that. I guess the other thing is that will give us a fresh emphasis and encouragement to have the difficult discussions. But they're not all difficult. I mean, many of us in this room have been back to the Appin massacre and commemoration in the year. The first probably very significant massacre in the world. So, 300 people died. It really needs to happen, led by maybe like the government, like the land councils, like the disciples societies, like the libraries, like the government, where community by community we get to know each other and we share the truth of that community. And this has worked in many places. It's not like it really invented the wheel, and I think that's the way to
work. It is. about blame, it's about how we learn together.
What's the place that we've been in the first time white people are actually coming to the West? I don't know if any of you have been out to the market to commemoration of the long weekend in June. Remarkable. It's totally like the we've got descendants of those that were massacred, and descendants of those that did the massacre decided that they wanted to do something. And it really is amazing and has changed. There's a promise in my mind that looks over the massacre sites. The massacre site is still private property. But you can, it's a kid, and people really spit from their hand on a rock or some sand from their beach and hand it to the memorial. It's just a place in the humans. I think
we've just got to keep thinking. We've got to be really clear about the behaviour and the effect of the competition. But we're smarter than that, and we want to do that. And we have the authority to make those decisions. Not that we're going to make those decisions, but I think as a country, I'm a realist and I understand the trauma that is deep. People are more, way more authority positions than I will ever be, and what the industry will be. But I think they need to feel the sentiment of the Australian community, and we need to unlock the voice of the 97% who back up us, who believe in us, and who want to go from Australian society to facts. And that's the gift that our community has been offering for a couple of years, and it's the gift that our community will continue to offer despite. Difficulties that have been made against the past that many of us still carry. That is our ongoing work with these new customer consciousness. It's our rituals that we see more and more people wanting to become increasingly curious about. And it's the ongoing use of place that I am on, or at least in my view, forever have been, if there's some reciprocity on the other side of the stomach. So I think that some of the institutions are sitting in the shadows. They're looking at the secrets of the government. And I've never had one of those at practice. I wouldn't know if it popped up at Calma to the world. But the reality was, he bravely and courageously said, you know what? This is the right thing to do. I'm going to put $1 million of my own money in the head. But I believe in this. These are very personal interests, and I'll just put it behind me. But if corporate institutions, they're all just went behind me. And you know what the country did? Took it to the birth of it, this is just the right thing to do. It's a process, and you know, all that. But it's just this, you know, what was the
fact? And you know, what was the
fact? So I think we need to find a way
Questions in a moment, but just one last question for me. In this spirit of being really positive about the prospect of treaty and institutions that are acting in a positive way, is there something you would say to people who've turned up tonight because they're curious, they're interested, and presumably have some commitment to this moving forward? As individuals, what can we do to progress this?
Thank you. Make sure you go home and share your knowledge. If you've learned tonight, if you've learned anything, you want to share it. And that is, back in your home, in your workplace, it's about conversations, it's about each of us being champions of the cause and being able to take it forward. We can't do it. We don't have to fight for it. We don't have to do it. We don't have to do it. We don't have to do it. One thing if you're a mum, you've got children, you find that your kids if you're working across all the work of study across the nation, you're working with kids from early childhood right through to secondary school, getting a perspective of our history through that. Within this sector, there's over 2,000 rights representatives taking up more and more getting on board. So, I'm very, very pleased that there's still efforts. We're going to see tons of kids coming through into the future with far better attitude than any of the adults that are out there. That's about the whole question. What influences us to make the decisions to think the way we are, and too often
Thank you.
you've got people who are sort of, if you've already joined in, be a multiplier. Be a multiplier. And invite people to participate. You know, people like kitchen tables, people like dinner parties, people in your workplace. You know, we are fortunate that we're doing a series of community events across the calendar year. Indigenous Week celebration, how we're doing with Panellists. We have an amazing celebration on the Calma expression. So, be a multiplier, invite people to join in, invite people to experience, you know, the generosity of the world, the intelligence of our culture, the people in our streets, aspects and traditions. Hopefully, we can do things.
Congratulations
to Victoria. Very long journey, and when I was working at the Department of Justice, back in the early 90s, we used to take a lot of very young people in this area, very spiritual place, very culturally significant, even though it's been a good part of the 25-year process. The one cluster is the community, public service, the Wash Barber, the Mifsud, state governments, the NAIDOC, Australia's 20th World Heritage listed site. It's Australia's only listed site for adding values. Many of our members have others incorporated in the heritage listing. But for Victoria, additional challenges around Aboriginality and identity and identity and representation, all those sorts of curious things. Very, very significant encouragement from the people, particularly people who are
So, on that note, questions. Are there people there who have something to ask? Chris, so, thank you.
Hello, yes. But the big challenge of the is
to the panel is that how do we bring Aboriginal people with
us? That's what I'm going to say. So yeah. How do we bring new science and quiz? This is just one of the things that we've done. We use this in other quiz and panels.
Thank you.
Can I just start with something?
Absolutely.
Can I tell you? Every question you have, it's about where in the sequence is the question you have to be answered. And that question very early in the Victorian process. Even the science field, even the Dutch paper field, is it individual families, a playing group, is it nations, is it language form? All of these respective questions. Now, where's semi-formed to it? In Victorian, not perfect. Not perfect. Next door to perfect, but not perfect. 70% of our traditional values in Victoria have some form of existing recognition or some form of community governance structure. So, at least in our regional corporations, we have six nations within our group structure, where we have 400 ancestors and 12 family groups. Our governance model stands for one family group, but we have one group. Our full group decision making process is one. We understand the complexity in 35 different so that's a very mature model that our old people put together 30 years ago. It stacks up. So the Victorian process really quickly. So we don't do a weight assembly. There were 33 people in that assembly by the end of October. The 12 recognised that we were parties, often as Jumbunna, we didn't want to be seat. We've done the work. We spent 30 years getting formal recognition, so we are going to make a seat. But if 30% of the state that don't have an automatic seat, when they get their recognition, they get an automatic recognition. Then there's just 21 general assembly positions that people have been waiting for, but they don't have to know. Once that assembly is elected, they've got three jobs. They don't negotiate between this is coming back to the local decision-making authority. So the assembly negotiate with the government to use these key contracts with the government. They negotiate with, it's commonly known as the Treaty Negotiation Framework. That's the rule book. For the first time ever in Victoria, we will allow them to elect our representatives, and we get to co-design, co-negotiate the rules of which they can summarise to then negotiate. It's pretty bloody powerful. They also get to negotiate the self-determination funds, that's the resource base for communities to build treaty readiness. We know our models get ready before we get the negotiation. The third thing they do is negotiate what is commonly known as the treaty authority or the umpire. Because when Eastern Mine have approved the government and negotiations, we need independent authority that one or the other can go to. It doesn't make sense. In any competition, there's a mediator, there's a moderator, there's a referee. The ghost that I walked with, I set up the fund and I established the umpire as the fund. Once that is all put in place, we need to get a legislator, we need to replace the funds. Our assembly is in legislation to resolve the South Australian situation. We'll report our thousands of states in the right process and then the SA government will write this for Wiradjuri. It is the government's in the right place. Where they get legislation in SA, if we have to go through the we got legislation pushed through. Once that architecture is built, Chris, then Eastern Mara, Gunditjmara, Calma, the traditional owner groups, then negotiate their own content as a result of that. Now, how we manage that inside the six nations that we represent, we're having those conversations in our country. Because the last thing that we would want is the six nations that couldn't have at least a mile of that stand for 30 years and all start winning in one of those that are around. They become bloody complex, really messy, because then my family will say, well, where are they that nation? We want family training. The idealism around that leads to the temple of the private company. We've got to keep competing in having those conversations. So that's a little bit of a story. Thank you.
International trading, so some of them are more interested, right? Some of them are just to see a lot of trade. Now, because it hasn't stored, it hasn't stored in the industry. The trade of water climate, which is only 40 years old in New Zealand, is still not very there, but it's quite a bit of issues unemployed and employable than that. British Columbia, which is the model that we have taken the approach to, can carry out what they call the modern trading process. There's a word that could be a practice of the trade of water climate. It's probably most commonly known in the Australian system. But the British model is the one that we have taken. And we have applied a place-based approach. But we haven't just gone to BC, we've just gone to the Burney and the Canberra. Because we've got our own politics, and we've got our own aspirations, and we've got our own infrastructure, including a very mature community control infrastructure that we need to be able to not pull down anything we do, but we need to build it process that just lifts up the existing ones that are already working on the time. But this is just my observation. I mean, people in my community say three out of every 5,000 of them are going to go away. It's not the one defining factor. There'd be a whole range of people who do which don't use them to do this. The one defining factor is time. Michael Capacity. Michael Capacity is the eldest connected citizen. Got the right negotiators and negotiators, and the young people feeling empowered through the process. So the term food readiness is not a throwaway slogan. It can't just be a throwaway slogan. It means bloody hard work, it means bloody hard work over a long time, and it's a continuous process like all of our organisations and all of our communities. And there's many in our communities who play a role. I've run an Eastern Northwest based return. I've run enough people for 15 years to get our capacity right. And we're embraced as a team to negotiate the contracts from that. And we're probably in the middle of improving our capacity in a few areas. We think we're probably 5% of the years away from being to negotiate from the year. There are other communities which will be good or bad for other communities to follow on that. Never on the risk of money. Not only what you want to do, but to not work your way out of the future. Because the impossible becomes possible. If governments carry out decisions about countries that you want, as the next generation of governments are being passed from now, you get more people in the market to say, oh, that's the way to go, we need to do better than they do, but they don't, they don't want to do things. So let's do it. If you have to say, this is the way, I think your model is this. People who are not going to be able to do that, because the one you've got over here is one of the most important things that we need to do.
areas of the treaty with the First Nations people are currently being taken to disenfranchise by the United States First Nations people who are new government employees.
Treaty, but it's not what we're doing. We don't feel what that means.
I think they're just a really choppy series of efforts in the very near future, because this is an example of a big corporate provide $1 million to the Institute of Public Health to go and do a big panel about what the respect is about and what that, which is all fine, except that that's only this way forward is not just in the statement, plus potentially the expert panel recommendations and other things inside that has a potential to cause some confusion in the community. And so, getting Linda together and colleagues to say, okay, this is going to be the leadership. How do we get the overview of the current government? Because we've got the federal government leading this alone, but at the same time, we've also got Paladin, the first minister, leading the coalition of Indigenous Panellists. And so, all these parties are going to start talking about a common understanding about the way forward.
I was up in We need to understand that our people are at different levels in different places. And we've got to be very cognizant of that in the discussion and in the negotiation. But many people from particularly small outback places are not part of this conversation. We're living in cowboys, with dirty water. So what is it we need to do for people in the world? It's a little bit of a perspective, which is something we need to do. I believe
we need to do it. 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 We need to do it.
It is very doable, and it's not as easy as saying to me.
And the message on it is that it's something that women feel to be there, and it's not necessarily going to go into the agreement or some kind of activity. It's a very powerful way to be in the place that you're trying to keep from participating in the process. And the lesson we learned from Victoria is that you can progress and make progress relatively fast in the near term, but you want to put the cash behind it to design the people to go out there and take it forward.
So I think we've been beaten by time now, actually. There's lots more to say, and I'm certainly learned a lot. Please join me in thanking the Justice Minister. Another one of the Professor Calma, who has this.